Good afternoon. So my name is Roman Belavkin. Thank you very much for the organization and the conference. So this talk was actually the result of my conversation with Giovanni Pistone at last conference, because I tried to convince him about something, and then we emailed, and I understood that it's not enough to just email, you need to write a paper. And so that was the... So the talk has a little small structure like this. So the point is, I'll start very quickly. So we use, try to, is this a, okay. So if we imagine a simplex of probability distributions or measures, we want to define some kind of divergence or distance function. And a very nice, useful one is the Kullback divergence, very well known. And it is very important because of this, it's actually unique in this sense. It's the only one that satisfies Hinchin axiom. It decomposes into a sum for independent variables. And of course, the reason for this is that it uses a logarithm in its definition, which is the unique homomorphism between multiplicative and additive groups. So that's actually the reason why it is the case. And it has a lot of nice properties. In fact, by the way, what I will be talking today is mainly important for infinite dimensional information geometry. Of course, questions of completeness and others, they're not really relevant in a finite dimensional case. And the infinite dimensional information geometry goes back to actually work of Chinsov, who in fact also proved that the uniqueness and existence of finitely generated Riemannian metric on infinite dimensional simplex. That's a less known result. I emailed to Amari as well, but if you want, I can give you theorem number in the paper of Morozova. Apart from all this convenient property, and by the way, invariant in Markov morphisms, I had to add in this. Apart from this convenient property, there is something seems to be very odd and inconvenient in some respect, is that it is known to be asymmetric. Yes, so one property that we well know is this. Of course, slightly less known property is the following, that if you represent Q, divergence of P from Q like this, it's not the same if you subtract by P minus Q. And that basically means that distance from Q to P is not the same as Q to in the other side. Yeah. By the way, these properties are not related unless this is a translation invariant distance. So it's to show this, I have plotted here symmetrized divergence. That's a ball diverging from Q, but with symmetrized divergence, you can still see it is not balanced in the sense. So this property is called not balanced. Of course, in infinite dimensional geometry, you want to you're interested in things like convergence and completeness, convergence of Cauchy sequences, and we want to define something like asymmetric distance. So you can, for example, define the following asymmetric, or called quasimetric, or quasi-pseudometric generally, but this is quasimetric, which can define like this. It's the infimum of this number, which by which you scale the difference. But effectively, what you do here, you just to understand here, if you have a set and you have a point which is not zero, and this is, let's say, some other point P, what you do is you subtract, you put this set to zero and look at P minus Q and scale it by alpha, and then put it back. Yeah, so that's what you're actually doing. You're looking at whether you can absorb this point into the set. And it's not the same as absorbing it from the other side, so the reflection. So that's why distance of P minus Q is not usually the same as quasimetric of P minus Q. So this is usually, so Giovanni Pistone, he used Banach spaces, very nice theory. Orlich spaces, in fact, is a very specific case. By the way, this is actually can be written, you can actually show that this expression can be written like this. And what usually is happening is that it's not convenient to have asymmetric or unbalanced neighborhood. So we can just put this absolute values here, right? So if you put this absolute value here, then you don't care about the order anymore. And it seems to be very innocent transformation, which and then of course you have Banach spaces, which are very nice. So they are complete normed spaces, and there's nothing, not a problem. But does it tell us anything about the original topology? The answer is actually no. And first of all, it's important to realize the following thing. So, of course, Banach spaces are metric spaces. Any normed space is a metric space, but not all topological spaces are metric spaces. On the other hand, a very known theorem says the following, that every topological space with countable base is some quasi-pseudometric space. So for any topological space with countable base, there exists a quasi-pseudometric that defines that topology. So it means the class of quasi-pseudometric spaces is much, much richer than metric spaces. It's non-symmetric, non-generated. So it only satisfies triangle inequality, and it is zero when you evaluate it on XX. Sorry? It is, it has a, this is the known result. So you can, metric spaces correspond to uniform spaces with countable uniformity. Quasi-pseudometric spaces correspond to quasi-uniform spaces with countable quasi-uniformity. And there are many inconveniences. First of all, just to list a couple of them, asymmetric semi-normed space can be T0, but it may not be maybe not T1. And that's therefore they are also not Hausdorff. A classical example is a real line equipped with a metric on a real line, which is defined as a maximum of y minus x and 0. So this is not, it's T0, but not T1. Of course, you can have two quasimetrics. For each quasimetric, you have a dual, which is the inverse order. And they generate different topologies. Then there are seven notions of Cauchy sequences. I will list them here. Left and right Cauchy, left, right, K Cauchy, K stands for Kelly, weak left, right, K Cauchy, and standard Cauchy. And with these two topologies, it gives you 14 notions of completeness. So that's already something quite disturbing, yes? And then, of course, there are the other notions. Like, for example, compactness is related to something called outer precompactness, which is strictly weaker property than precompactness, and this is still strictly weaker than total boundedness. So you can have a not totally bounded set, but still compact. And asymmetric semi-normed spaces fail to be topological vector spaces very often, because operation by multiplication by scalar is actually not necessarily continuous. And the article of Baradin, very nice in 2001, gives examples. And there are many, and by the way, these completenesses don't necessarily imply each other. For one type of completeness, you have examples that, so it's a huge inconvenience, that seems. That's why, of course, it's nice to put consider only Banach spaces, but it doesn't tell us very much about the original topology, which only resulted in putting absolute value. We only just put absolute value, and we think we'd solved everything. So practically all other results have to be reconsidered, like Bayes category theorem and Alaoglu-Bourbaki and all other results. This is actually quite interesting new area of topology, and there is a symmetric functional analysis now. That's a kind of area. And the ideas that I will cover here today is the following. So first of all, what we're interested in, we're looking at this kind of neighborhood of zero, let's call it M. By the way, when I use this notation, X and Y. By this, I usually mean a pairing of two spaces. And it could be, for example, a sum of X, Y. But we could also use an integral of X, Y with some measure. Or we could use, in fact, trace of some self-adjoint operators. So in fact, there is it's not necessarily limited. So we have now a neighborhood of zero. Which is a set, and we'll consider polar set. A polar set is defined like this, is a convex closed convex set that contains always zero, but we shall assume that we have a zero inside the set, because if we don't, we can always shift it to that subtractive point. And what happens here, we can see the Minkowski functional, which is basically considers an array defined by some point x, yeah, and this is infimum of alpha, and you want to absorb this x divided by lambda into this set. This, in fact, corresponds to support function of the original set. So, so every array in this space corresponds to a hyperplane and half space in the dual space. So this, in fact, this Minkowski function of the polar set is exactly support function of the set like this, which is support supremum of xy, where I be, for all y belonging here. And you can see what is the symmetry here. If we have unbalancedness, means that the length you need from zero to this point and to the minus this point is not the same. This, in fact, corresponds to the supremum achieved here is not the same as you consider here. And this set that we'll consider in information geometry, well, of course, we're interested by, so let's say, a kind of like a unit ball, but defined by divergence. So we'll consider in this space here a space of all probability measures that diverge from a reference measure by, let's say, not than one bit or one knot. And this, in fact, is just an expression of Kullback divergence in terms of U, where U is P Q minus 1. So actually, if you plug it in there, you will get this nice form of... actually, Giovanna Pistone uses this kind of transformation as well. And in this space, in fact, the polar set is a kind of also neighborhood. I use here approximately equal, because to have equality, have to have some other constant here, not 1. But if I just have a sublevel of 1, this is a divergence here with the star, it means defined by the Legendre transform functional. And of course, for this function, this corresponds to a Coulomb generating function, where x now is the element of the dual space. Now, what are these spaces? This space is a space of measures, or if we are normalizing them, they are probability measures. And this space corresponds to random variables, algebra of random variables. And it's important to remember that x and minus x, random variable x, is not the same as minus x. This is why, in fact, we have asymmetry. So, in fact, the source of asymmetry is precisely this, usually related to optimization problems. So I just give quite, but in fact, I actually find asymmetry of information a very interesting property. So we should not get rid of it because it tells us a lot about a random phenomena. And one couple of examples is the following. Let's consider St. Petersburg lottery. So we have a coin that we flip several times until the first head appears. And then we win 2 power n pounds or euros. And for a fair coin, we know that this actually gives us infinite expected win. So that's related to St. Petersburg paradox, how much we are ready to pay for such lottery. And for some reason, we are not ready to pay an infinite amount of money. We only pay 1 pound or one coin. But what I want to make here is the following, that expectation, notice that if we have a biased coin towards head, oh, sorry, towards tail perhaps, yeah? Towards head, yeah. If it's biased towards head slightly, then it's again, it immediately becomes finite expectation for any bias, but it doesn't become, it's not so if we have a bias in another direction. And what it tells us is that this random variable x, 2 power n, it lives in a space, which it means it does not belong to the interior of the domain of the Coulomb generating function. It means the zero in that space is not in the interior of this domain. And that's actually quite important. So 2 power n belongs to the domain, but the minus 2 power n doesn't, because if you put it here, it doesn't converge, it has infinite value. So 0 is not in the interior of the domain of the Coulomb generating function in this space. Another example is related to error minimization. Let's say we want to minimize a squared Euclidean distance between two random variables A and B, but we want minimize them over all distributions which satisfy this constraint. This is Shannon information written this is joint distribution, these are two marginals. The solutions of these are exponential family distributions like of this form. They are finite, but it's important to understand the maximization of x has no solution. So minimization of minus x corresponds to maximization of x. So if you put, instead of negative minus Euclidean distance here, if you have positive, of course it doesn't. And there is no solution. In Euclidean space, there is no distribution that gives you maximum Euclidean distance, because such doesn't exist, actually. Okay, so again, we have the same kind of thing here. So this actually related to many other examples, but I'll just tell you what we can do with this. In fact, we can prove a lot of nice properties in this case. And the method is based on what I call a symmetric sandwich or symmetric Orlich sandwich. So if you imagine a support function of set A, which is a, let's say, some kind of unbalanced set containing zero, we can always majorize them above by support of minus A union A, and below by support of A and intersection with minus A. This corresponds to the following in terms of Minkowski functionals for polar sets. And it is known that you can actually prove that the lower bound is given by the following. It is a convex closure infimum of support of minus A and support of A. And it is actually equal to convolution, infimal convolution of S and, S and S of minus A. And the upper bound here is given, in fact, is just a supremum of support of A and support of minus A. And what we're looking at is the following. We have a set. We have now its reflection. And we're looking at the intersection, which in the dual space corresponds to the convex closure infimum, convex closure, and the opposite, convex closure corresponds in the polar to intersection. And the idea is that to define such interior symmetrized ball and exterior, which actually are Banach spaces unit balls. And then we have two Banach spaces, which one is below, another is above our symmetric space. And that gives us a lot of properties. And to do this, in fact, it's easy to consider, in our case, for Kullback divergence, we have the following two kernel functions. One is the one that I've written before in terms of this U. So if you integrate this with respect to Q, you'll get Kullback divergence. Its dual is the following function here. These are plots of these functions. Now, usually what happens, I mentioned, that we use absolute value of U. So if we put absolute value of U, what happens? Basically, we have this symmetrized version here in the dual space that gives us this symmetrization. It is known that this function, for example, belongs to something called delta 2 class, and this doesn't. But we can also do another symmetrization. We can use minus absolute value of U, and that corresponds to the following symmetrization here and the following symmetrization here. Now, this does not belong to delta 2, and this belongs. And this, in fact, gives us two. These are symmetric norms, and this gives us, in fact, two Orlich or so-called Luxembourg norms. In fact, if you integrate with these functions with that, in fact, this is what we have. In fact, there's a proposition here that phi plus and phi minus star in this space are Luxembourg norms with the following bounds, upper and lower bound on our original asymmetric norm. And the same happens but now you see plus and minus have exchanged here because of this polarity. And that gives us a couple of results. So results are the following. The first of all, Kullback divergence, after all, induces Hausdorff topology. And to see this, you can just the following. So you know that we can define, for our asymmetric norm, we can define a norm that is a lower bound. What it means is that there is a norm topology, and our asymmetric norm topology is finer than the norm topology because of this inequality. And that means that our topology is also Hausdorff. So it has a separated neighborhoods. Next, you can also show that, in fact, this norm space, has a weaker topology, is, in fact, a separable Orlich space. And I'm not going into details, but it is related to the fact that the functions I've just mentioned before belong to the so-called delta 2 class. It's a very important property in this theory of Orlich spaces. And the final result is about completeness, which is probably the most interesting. So, and probably also what I've started is important. First of all, the topologies that I have just mentioned, they are so-called bicomplete, and that means symmetrized sequences, Cauchy sequences, converge in a symmetrized metric. And that is related also to so-called raw sequential completeness, which means that these sequences actually converge in our original asymmetric or quasimetric. And finally, it actually turns out that they are also so-called right K sequentially complete. It means right K Cauchy sequences converge in raw. Just a couple of words about the proof. So now here we're using another Banach space, which is now inside, so which is majorizing our, not lower bound, but upper bound of our symmetric norm.
So remember, so first of all, if you consider asymmetric, so symmetrized distance in this sense with index s, it is in fact our symmetric distance of z minus y and supremum y minus z. Yeah. You can actually show that the metric that I, of Banach space that I have shown before is in fact more or equal to this. In fact, this one is a, in fact is a least upper bound. But this is upper bound, but not necessarily least. But this is Banach space, so it is complete. And to prove this, all these properties, you need to use two theorems. One is of Riley and co-authors in 1982, and another is Chen and co-authors in 2007. I'll just tell you very quickly what this means. So the first theorem is says that if you have a sequence of sets, nested sets of finite diameter, so where diameter of a set is defined as a supremum over supremum of our asymmetric distance x y, and x and y belong to F. And so if you have, imagine you have a set F, you can clearly see, because it's supremum of xy, it means in fact it is supremum with respect to symmetrized. It is in fact diameter with respect to symmetrized metric. And that means you are looking at nested balls with a symmetric metric here inside. And the theorem says that if this intersection of all these sets is non-empty, then if and only then it is complete. And of course, this space we know is Banach, so it is complete. So because these balls have non-empty intersection, obviously our original sets also have non-empty intersection. And a similar property goes for the last. And another property. So I'm not going into the details of these different notions of completeness, but they are all, in a sense, weaker. So this is by complete. In fact, is our usual completeness, but these are weaker conditions. Okay. So basically, just a summary of results. So topologies induced by asymmetric information divergences may not have the same properties as their symmetrized counterparts, and therefore we have to reconsider some of the results, most of the results, in fact, if we are interested in the symmetric properties. So here we prove the following properties, that it's a Kullback divergence induces Hausdorff topology, which is very nice. It is B-complete, Rho sequentially complete, and also right K sequentially complete. And in fact, it also contains a separable Ehrlich subspace, although the whole space itself may not be separable. I haven't considered total boundness and compactness, but I think it's we're looking at sets, so subsets, of course. And there are many other interesting questions you can consider. What about other asymmetric information distance, like Rene, for example, or other? They're also asymmetric. So what about them? And you can apply the same methodology to study them. This is all, and there's a couple of references. Thank you very much.